Good afternoon and good morning, everyone, all the people, Homeopathic lovers and Homeopathic practitioners. Well, today's topic, what has been chosen, is very nice. That why Homeopathy is second in the world. If we look at it, that why we are second, or we can see why the other system is number one. So if there are certain lackings, certain shortcomings from our side, we need to work on that to become number one. And as Dr. Shadi has told very clearly the scope of homeopathy, where we have been, working as a for pediatrics, for geriatrics, for sports, for pregnant lady, for everything. It is one of the best medicines, which no doubt about it. But still, we are considered to be number two in the world. WHO also acclaimed and agreed to it that homeopathy is number two, which the largest number of second number people are taking the homeopathic medicine all over the world. Now, doing the introspection, what we need is a real introspection why we are at number two. First, what I feel that we have certain issues. As Dr. Kujat had said about the political and internal, non-unity or so, or different format of schools of thoughts have come up. That has also made people segregated about it. Instead of having a unified approach, there is a people who are having some segregation, which is one of the cause. But coming to the basics, why the world has not taken it as a number one, and why we are lacking, where we are lacking. To my mind, what I feel that we have not been able to communicate with the people, we have not been able to make the people understand that how the homeopathic medicines work. This is one particular area where we need to work, our scientists need to work, or we need to give them a proper reply. One. Number two, we always talk of, whenever we talk of the medication, we go on for the individualization. Individualization for homeopathy is must. Individualization is our USP, and it is, strength, and at the same time, it is a weakness. I might be sounding not very good to few homeopaths, considering it to be individualization as a weakness. But when you come to the practical side, like a patient or a person who is down with a fever, having 100, 200, 3 temperature, or there's a patient who is suffering from acute headache, there's a patient who is suffering from acute colic. Like in modern medicine, they do have what certain medicines, fixed medicine, at least to give the relief to that particular patient without asking much of the symptomatology or without individualization. Here, we become little handicapped. We found ourselves to be little handicapped when a patient over the phone, he says, I'm having 103 fever, or his attendant tells that patient is not in a position to, give you the symptoms, give you the complete case history. But we need to have some kind of an antipyretic. I'm sounding little different than the classical method. I do not say that classical method is not good. It is very, very good. But when we are talking about the situation where we lack, where we takes us back from the number one. So we are not in a position to handle the acute condition there and then by having certain fixed medication. When we talk to the patient, we say that we need a complete case history, we need details and all that. And in the meantime, a patient who is not in the condition to give that kind of history, he goes for an immediate, SS medication in the form of modern medicine. He might take an antipyretic, he might take an analgesic, or he might take an anticholic medicine, which gives him relief. If we found, on this particular platform, going away from the basic theory, I'm talking about the practical side. In majority of the cases, when there's a patient who is in a very acute condition, he does not go to a homeopath. Reason being this, that we have not been able to get that kind of a confidence among the people that those kind of a situation can be taken care of. Yes, patients come to us once they have tried, they have taken allopathic medicines, they have tried different medicines, and then they come to a homeopathic medicine for a curative purpose. Agreed. We can definitely, and we are very good at it. That's what I said, that individualization can lead to the curative aspect. But in the acute, very, very acute condition, in SS kind of a condition, that individualization becomes a little difficult. And suppose even if you want, individualize and want to give one particular medicine called, suppose, for example, Belladonna. And if Belladonna is not available, then again, we do not know what to do. Because if we say that you come and give him Belladonna, the patient says, I do not have Belladonna. Then what are we going? We become left on that because we do not have got any alternative. Like in modern medicine, if you don't have got analgesic of number A, then you can have try give them number 2, number 3. They've got a certain kind of protocol. So what we need to, in my mind, we need to develop some kind of a protocol for acute emergencies in which if this is not there, that can be given because the patient wants to be relieved at that time. If we talk of that we want to cure, we would like to go on the anti-miasmatic background, we will see this. We'll see that. The suppression and all that. So the patient is not going to stick to us. This is one reason where I find that people, opt for the other medication instead of homeopathy. Then there's a belief that homeopathy works slow, which I do not agree. Yes, but we have not been able to, draw this kind of a confidence among the masses. The common trend and common feeling among the people are this, that homeopathy works slow. Again, because most of the cases which come to us, they are chronic cases. They are chronic cases, they are in a bad shape where it is bound to take time. And I, as always say, had the patient come to us in a very acute condition, and had he come to us where we could have taken the case history, we could have individualized the case, probably we would have been able to give the correct medicine from our side and get the desirable result within no time. But very seldom this happens. So this has become a kind of a regular practice over a period of time. People experience that whenever they asked the acute emergency, they could not be helped with the medicine, homeopathic medicine. That is why they take the treatment and it takes time to show the result. So that becomes slowness of the treatment, which I do not agree, which I do not say, but we are talking from the perspective of the people's side. Third is that we are not able to communicate that the homeopathic fraternity have not been able to communicate that how our medicine would work. When they talk of this, you take this medicine, this will work on neurotransmitter, this will work on this thing, physiologically in this thing, and when chemical medicines are given in the form of allopathic. So there they have a definite fixed pattern to make the people understand. When the homeopath is being asked from a doctor that how it was going to work, he finds very difficult to give him a proper reply. We say that vital energy is there. We, as Dr. Hanneman has said, we have got theoretical part is fine, but he is not a student of homeopathy who would understand everything in that detail. If we could make the people understand in a simple manner, in this, like what happened in your physiology, what happened in your pathology, what this medicine works, probably then he or she would be able to relate his problems with that medication and then expect with the result, and they'll stick with the confidence. But once we are not able to give that kind of a satisfactory answer, the patient finds little difficult for him to stick to that particular medicine and that. Then, as I said, that we if we can have some kind of a protocols would be, I mean, like, even if it is in India, or it is in, I mean, Netherlands, or it is in Pakistan, or it is in Philippines, some statistical things which we know are being formed by our homeopathic fraternity, that this would work definitely. Yes, it would make a lot of difference. Like we have got, say, about couple of, I mean, medicines with the consensus of the entire homeopathic fraternity that these are good for these particular things, as we call it a regional affinity, or we call it as a medicine which has got an effect on those particular things. But not sticking to that again causes little confusion in the mind of the people as well as the doctor, what to do and what not to do at that time. Now, another thing is the political side. It is, which is very, very, I mean, important, because allopathic is being guided by this, I mean, pharma industry, and they are multi-billionaire dollar industries. So they have been able to capture, they have been able to advertise themselves, they have been able to get the articles written for them and against any other system. Where we lack, that we do not have that kind of a platform or a lobby, which we need to create, I mean, if we want to, I mean, compete with the number one, we need to create a lobby for homeopathy also. Which we have got lots and lots of cases which at an individual level, but they are not being highlighted. Then we do not have any platform where you can showcase your, I mean, the kind of cases. Like, you do not have got any referral place. In allopathy, they have got, I mean, from one particular physician, if he finds some difficult cases, he is able to refer that patient to some center or some hospital, dedicated for that particular problem. So we find very, very difficult where we do not have any referral place where we can refer our patient to, I mean, from, suppose, for in India. We have got National Institute of Homeopathy, that is in Calcutta. But again, it has not been able to get that kind of a reputation from where the difficult cases can be referred. So we ought to have some centers or, I mean, hospitals dedicated where the referral cases can be sent, and there we are able to show the results. Because in private practice, everyone near doesn't have that much of a time, that much of a facility, so to carry on. But the patient who comes to him or her, if he is not able to stick because of certain reason, and if there is one particular place like a hospital, like a center, where the patient has been taken care of, with this all kind of, investigations required, proper case study and repatriation can be done and evaluated, and then it can be treated. So this is another reason where we feel that we lack, and because of no referral place, we lose our identity, because ultimately it comes to one homeopath gets failed, so people think it's a failure of homeopathy, which is not true. As I said, that we normally say that homeopathy never fails. It is true, but it is a homeopath who might have failed because of various reasons. I am not discussing that. I mean, what particular medication he has given, what particular methodology he has adopted. There are people who believe in acute prescription. There are people who believe in starting with a very low potency. There are people who give straight away with higher potency. So there are a lot of differences among.
Yes, doctor. Please conclude within a minute.
Okay. So these are certain issues which I feel that we need to work collectively, as we say that homeopathy ensures health safely, but we need to create that kind of showcase for the people to understand. And we are not able to give our writings or articles in the peer-reviewed journals, like international journals of reputation. If we are able to do some kind of, like, from this platform of IPH, we collect that kind of a data and publish, with authenticity, yes, it would be recognized. Like, I mean, I may say that I treated this, that. I mean, Dr. Alila may say she treated that. Dr. Osman said I treated that. But collectively, we do not have anything to, I mean, show as a, I mean, literature where it has been taken and considered by the other people. With this, I think I would like to, I mean, end. And,
Thank you, Dr. Gupta. Now it is time for Dr. Usman, Dr. Muhammad Usman from Pakistan. You have 10 minutes, Doctor. Please unmute. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Shahji. I'm audible?
Yes.